Laskyan Korla, one question that very few will be brave enough to ask me is my age. If you did, however, I would say that I'm young enough to be a working mother of two teenage boys, that I am committed to public service and was privileged to have been appointed not just as Ireland's 19th female member of Cabinet, but also Ireland's first female lawyer at Cabinet. However, in terms of this debate, I would tell you that I'm old enough to know that there are very few women my age who have not been subjected to some form of sexual assault in their respective lifetimes. And I know this because I'm one of them. It won't come as a surprise to those of us of a similar age who have suffered this trauma. And sometimes we have suffered it more than once. It was and is a lot more common than many believe. And I always take statistics that I read with a pinch of salt. Most victims do not report their crimes. There are many reasons for this. Shame, a fear of judgment, and a desire to forget are among the reasons, and it shouldn't be this way. And it is, as the Taoiseach said earlier, a form of a hidden abuse. But it's important to say that not all abuse is continuous. There can be isolated incidents that can be just as damaging, either at home or outside the home. And no doubt there's someone watching this speech live or reading it later, somewhere near to you at this very moment in time, in a town, a public space, an office, a street, or a home, where some form of sexual assault or violation is taking place. And the Me Too movements, the Reclaim the Night movement after the Sarah Everard murder in London, and the social media support for Sarah Grace after the brutal, savage attack she suffered in Dublin have highlighted even more so how vulnerable we can be as women. The scary part about sexual assault in particular is that it is not always the random monster in the middle of the night, but often a friend or a spouse or an acquaintance or someone you know. It is a corrosive blight on female safety and morale. Laskyan Korla, you know too well that many of the 36 women TDs and 18 senators may disagree in terms of ideology and policy, but on a completely personal and human level, we will all agree on one thing. We are all very much a part of the unfinished democracy that is Ireland when it comes to the representation and treatment of women. How much we decide to share is purely a personal decision, but I know that I'm surrounded in this House by remarkable, talented, strong women who are all doing their best to bring about a fair and compassionate Ireland, regardless of what challenges we may each have faced. And while I'm on the subject, Laskyan Korla, I hope that a full debate will be afforded to members to discuss the further constitutional reforms that have been proposed by the Citizens' Assembly on gender equality. And I await a response from all party leaders in relation to this, and indeed the Minister of Equality, who I know is here in the House today, on my correspondence in relation to the establishment of a special Oireachtas committee. And I would be grateful for the Taoiseach, from the Taoiseach also, for a response in this regard. Obviously, as a practising family lawyer, I'm particularly interested in the progression of the Family Courts Bill, which I know has already been said in the House today, and I would echo that. I do want to welcome the work that has been carried out by the Department of Justice and Ministers Humphreys and Minister Nocton, who's here in the chamber, in relation to the Third National Strategy on Domestic, Sexual and Gender-Based Violence, which will place a priority on prevention and reduction and should hopefully include a national preventative strategy. And while we must do everything we can to prevent domestic and sexual violence, we must also be realistic and acknowledge that new victims will continue to experience violations. And therefore, we must be very aware of the impact that this new strategy will have on both new and existing victims. And I note the public consultation for this eagerly awaited and most important document closed 3 weeks ago. And I hope that the Minister will be able to provide further updates on the strategy in due course. And furthermore, I hope that we will also receive updates from the Department of Justice on the development and delivery of the National Survey on the Prevalence of Sexual Violence in Ireland by the Central Statistics Office. In recent weeks, I have read the stark and alarming figures that are contained in the annual reports of Women's Aid and also FLAC, and indeed the many other organisations who play a role in assisting victims of gender-based violence. And since it first arrived on our shores, all of the emerging data and reports from those on the front lines have shown a dramatic increase in the many forms of violence against women and children, particularly in the home, a place that is supposed to be a haven and a sanctuary and a safe space. And while most of us have worked hard to ensure that COVID-19 was kept out of our houses, for some women and children, the real danger was not something found in the air, but rather in the home itself. Almost 31,000 people felt the need to reach out to Women's Aid to make a disclosure of abuse. That's a 43% increase on 2019. And when broken down, the grim reality is crystal clear. A 30% increase in emotional abuse disclosures, a 24% increase in physical abuse, and a 41% increase in sexual abuse. And what is even more frightening is that these figures are only considering instances that occurred up until December 2020, which is well before we entered the most recent and longest wave of Level 5 restrictions. Shortly before the election of the current government, I remember stressing at Cabinet the importance of providing additional supports and options for those women and children who were facing into a torturous reality of being further trapped with offenders. And that was why I welcomed the non-application of the 5 kilometre travel limit to those who were escaping dangerous domestic scenarios, and also the recently extended partnerships of Airbnb and Safe Ireland to provide temporary accommodation to victims of domestic violence. And I was also glad to play my part in assisting with this collaboration in its first iteration. I've always wanted victims of these horrific crimes to know that they are a priority for government, and that support is always available for them. And that's not to say, by the way, that men don't also suffer from sexual assault and violence, as they do, and they should be supported wholeheartedly. It is simply a fact, however, that is much more prevalent an issue for women. The violence that is emerging now as a dark feature of this pandemic is a mirror and a challenge to our values, our resilience and our shared humanity. Laskian Kiorla, I raised this topic during the term of the 32nd Dáil when I was a backbencher. I'm not sure if members are familiar with the Eurythmics song Sex Crime 1984 and those 4 powerfully tragic lines that Annie Lennox uses to perfectly encompass how victims of sexual assault continue to feel. And so I face the wall, turn my back against it all. How I wish I'd been unborn, wish I was unliving here. What some people fail to understand is that the consequences and repercussions of a sexual offence on a victim are multifaceted. The scale of the damage inflicted varies from one victim to the next, depending on the
Minister,
level.
Minister, I'm just not sure if you're aware you're sharing with Deputy Devlin.
I'm not aware that I'm sharing time.
You're down here for sharing time.
Okay,
with him.
Apologies.
Yeah, he has 5 minutes.
Okay, yeah, that's fine.
Sorry to interrupt you, but
thank you. Yeah.